This is chapter 7, gaseous exchange. Now, gaseous exchange in the STPM syllabus is divided in three parts: 7.1 gaseous exchange in human, 7.2 breathing cycle, and 7.3 gaseous exchange in plants. To start off this chapter, I will start with 7.1 gaseous exchange in human. Let's have a look at the detailed syllabus of 7.1. There are altogether 5 parts, but today's video will only cover part A, that is to outline the structure of the human respiratory system. Okay, that's one. And then we must know the microscopic structure of the wall of an alveolus. So now let's look at the human respiratory system. Okay, you are very familiar with this structure. This is the rib cage. So the outermost structure that protects the respiratory system inside is the rib cage. Now, if I were to remove the rib cage, you will find that you can see the lungs. Okay, but actually between the rib cage and the lung, there is a space. That space is called the pleural membrane. Okay, then if we go deeper into the lung, you will be able to see the alveolus. Since we have looked at the physical structure of the respiratory system, we move on to discuss the movement of air into the respiratory system. Okay, so I introduce the two air molecules here. Now, air can enter the respiratory system either through the nostril into the space known as the nasal cavity or into the buccal cavity through your mouth. Okay, so this space in the mouth region is the buccal cavity. The space at the nose region is the nasal cavity. Now, once the air is present in these two cavities, three things happen to air. Firstly, the air is warmed. Okay, it will come, the temperature from room temperature will be increased to our body temperature with the help of the blood capillaries located in the cavities. Second thing that happens to air is that air which is in a gaseous state will be moistened or dissolved with the help of the mucous membranes located in the cavity. Like here, this is the skin or the layers of the cavity, but here you can see some liquid that is the mucous membranes. The third thing that happens to the air is that it is filtered. Okay, because the hair will carry along with it dust and microparticles which can include pathogens. So the nasal hair will help to filter the air, and deeper inside the cavity there are also ciliated epithelium cells, okay, which will help in the filtering process. Once air has been warmed, has become dissolved and also filtered, the air then travels through the pharynx. Pharynx is the location in our respiratory system where the digestive system, that is the esophagus, meets with the respiratory system. Okay, but of course the trachea will be in front and the esophagus will be at the back. So from the pharynx then, the air will travel down to the larynx here. Okay, the unscientific term for larynx is the voice box. This voice box is not so visible in women, but in boys or men, you can see at their neck, there will be a bulge. That is the larynx. Okay, theirs, in the males, it is bigger, and that is why their voice is more deeper compared to ladies. Okay, now from the larynx, where does air move? It will now enter the trachea. Okay, the common term for trachea is the windpipe. okay, but we use the scientific term that is the trachea. Now, trachea is a special structure, okay, because it is actually strengthened by a protein that is cartilage. So you can see in this operation where they have opened up the neck, you can see the trachea with all these lines. These lines are actually the cartilage. In fact, if you touch your own neck, you will be able to feel the cartilage, the presence of the cartilage, because at your trachea, the surface is not smooth. Now, the function of the cartilage is to make sure that the trachea remains open so that air can continuously move down the trachea. Okay. And it also prevents collapse or buckling of the trachea. Okay, so if you see, if something presses onto your neck, okay, actually the trachea does not collapse. That means doesn't close up lah. But if you are choking the person, the cartilage is not as strong as a bone. So of course, the trachea can, if you are seriously choking the person, the trachea can become compressed. Okay, now inside the trachea, if you can see in this picture, you can see these lines, that's the cartilage, and you can see there is mucus forming. Okay, now this mucus is secreted by goblet cells located in the trachea, and the function of this mucus is to trap dust and microbes. Okay, now you must remember in the buccal cavity and the nasal cavity, there was also mucus. But the mucus there had a different function, that is to actually provide moisture to help dissolve the gases. Okay, but in the trachea, the mucus has a different function, that is to help trap dust and microbes. Earlier, I also mentioned that in the nasal cavity especially, there are hair follicles as well as ciliated epithelial cells that filter dust and microbes. They don't trap, they filter. The mucus at the trachea are the ones that will trap the dust and the microbes. And then the ciliated epithelial cells in the trachea, okay, they don't filter. Instead, they will move the mucus, the dust, and the microbes up, okay, back to the pharynx. Okay, so it will move from the larynx to the pharynx here. Okay, and the objective is to either help you cough it out, or in a different situation, to help you swallow so that it enters your digestive system and the acids of your digestive system can help to destroy the mucus, dust, and microbes. Okay, from the trachea, the air then travels into the bronchus, that is these two branches here, and inside the lungs, the bronchus will divide further into bronchioles. Okay, and finally, air will arrive at the alveolus, which is where gaseous exchange happens by simple diffusion. So next, we are going to look at the microscopic structure of alveolus. You are very familiar with this external appearance of the alveolus, but if we use a scanning electron microscope and view the alveolus, the cross-section of the alveolus appears like so. Okay, so these are the epithelial cells that make up the alveolus, and you can see the air space within. Now, if we use a high-powered light microscope, then we can see structures like this, where you can see there's lots of air space, places where there is like a reddish appearance inside. These are actually the blood vessels. The ones that have empty space, like what I've circled here, is the alveoli, and this will be the blood capillaries, like here, okay, the arteries and the veins that are surrounding the alveolus. Okay, but now let's go deeper into the structure using a diagram. Okay, This once again is the alveolus. The blue color is the alveolus. The red color are the blood capillaries. Now, the blood capillaries are made up of endothelial cells. And of course, inside the blood capillaries, there are going to be your red blood cells, that is the erythrocyte. Okay, then you have the air space here. And actually, inside the air space of our lungs, there are tiny, tiny little cells known as the macrophage. Okay, and their function is to carry out phagocytosis. So, for example, now, with the COVID pandemic, we know that COVID enters our body via the respiratory system. So generally, when COVID enters into the alveolus, our macrophage actually will do phagocytosis. Okay, the only problem is when the amount of the virus is too much, then the macrophage is unable to digest all of the virus, and then because of that, the virus starts to infect the alveolar cells, okay, leading to respiratory problems, which is one of the main symptoms of COVID infection. We will learn this about infection in chapters 12 and 13. Okay, I move on now to the cells that make the alveolus. Okay, they are epithelial cells. Blood capillaries, the cells are endothelial cells, but the alveolus cells are epithelial cells. There are two types, okay, called type 1 and type 2. Take note of how the 1 and 2 is written. You are not going to write it like in maths. Okay, you write as in the Roman letter 1 and 2, Roman numbers. Okay, pneumocyte, cyte, remember, means cell, just like erythrocyte, leukocyte. So, cyte here, it means cell. Pneumo here is related to lung. So, that's why you see lung infections, they call as pneumonia. So, pneumo refers to lung. So, pneumocyte actually means lung cells. So you have type 1 pneumocytes, these are these cells here, and this is type 2 pneumocytes. So let's move on to the details of the microscopic alveolus structure. The outermost layer of the alveolus is made up of the basement membrane. Okay, you've learned this actually in semester 1. All epithelial cells are built on the basement membrane. So likewise, for the alveolus, it is on this basement membrane where we have the pneumocytes. We have type 1 pneumocyte and over here type 2 pneumocytes. The basement membrane, of course, is made up of collagen proteins, which helps to give structure to the alveolus. And then we find 95% of the alveolus is made up of type 1 pneumocytes. The structure of the pneumocyte is, we've also learned in semester 1, is made up of simple squamous epithelium cells. Okay, simple telling us that it is single layer. And squamous cells are, remember, the thinnest and flattest of epithelium cells. Okay, now since it can provide a larger surface area, it is at the type 1 pneumocytes where gaseous exchange occurs. Now, if you look at the structure of the type 2 pneumocytes, you can see it is more cuboidal. So, it is not suitable for gas exchange. It has lots of vesicles telling us that its function is more to secrete surfactant. Okay, surfactant is a chemical made up of phospholipid, carbohydrates and proteins. Okay, and this surfactant actually provides moisture to the alveolus. Okay, and in this way helps to decrease the surface tension between the gaseous air and the moisture surface inside the alveolus. Its presence also helps to prevent the alveolus from collapse. Okay, so since there is liquid, a little bit of liquid here, so the alveolus cannot shrink too much. Similar to trachea. Trachea is prevented from collapse by the presence of cartilage. So for alveolus, it is the presence of the surfactant that prevents it from collapse. Okay, now, if necessary, if say type 1 pneumocyte cells, some of the cells are dead or damaged, then these type 2 pneumocytes can differentiate into type 1. Okay, now, other than these three basic things, we look next at what is in the airspace. The airspace is where both oxygen and carbon dioxide will accumulate, okay, based on the partial pressure. Of course, when we inhale, the oxygen partial pressure will be high, and when we exhale, the carbon dioxide partial pressure will be high. Okay, other than that, the airspace may also contain macrophages, which I explained earlier. So their job is to keep our body safe from infection through air by ingesting microbes and small particles that entered as we inhaled. Okay, so that is why most of the time we are healthy. It is only when the amount of microbes in the inhaled air is too much, that's when we start to have infection like flu, influenza, bronchitis, pneumonia, and now COVID. Okay, next we will discuss how the structure of the alveolus is adapted for its function in gaseous exchange. First thing we'll talk about is about the number of alveoli. Each lung in our body has about 300 million alveoli. Added to that, each alveoli has, remember, about 95% of type 1 pneumocytes, which are simple squamous epithelial cells. So the number of alveoli plus the number of pneumocytes, okay, type 1 pneumocytes, enable our lung to have an extremely large surface area. And anything that has a large surface area will be able to increase the rate of exchange. So this is the first adaptation. The second adaptation of the alveoli is still related to that 95% of type 1 pneumocytes, okay, which, as I earlier mentioned, is made up of the simple squamous epithelial cells. Okay, now, the squamous epithelial cells are thin and flat, and the fact that they are simple tells us that it is a single layer. So together, this tells us that the alveolar wall is extremely thin. So when it is thin, the distance for the gas to travel from the airspace into the blood vessel or from the blood vessel into the airspace is extremely short. So because of that, the rate of diffusion is higher, or diffusion can occur faster. So this is the second adaptation. The third adaptation is related to the type 2 pneumocytes. Earlier, I've told you type 2 pneumocytes actually secrete surfactant, okay, which provides moisture in the alveolus. So when the alveolus is moist, what happens is it is able to dissolve the gases and at the same time reduce surface tension between air and liquid. So this way, we find that the rate of diffusion of the gases is increased. This is the third adaptation. Moving on to the fourth adaptation, this is related to the basement membrane. Now, the basement membrane, as mentioned earlier, is made up of collagen fibers. And what's special about collagen fibers is that it is elastic. So when it is elastic, what happens is, as we inhale air, the collagen can stretch. So when it stretches, the alveolus expands. Okay, but because the collagen is also strong, we find that the alveolus will not rupture. Okay, now when we exhale, what happens is the collagen will recoil. go back to normal, and this way the alveolus can return to its original shape. Okay, we move on then to the next. We now move on to the fifth adaptation. Okay, it is about something called stretch receptors. Stretch receptors are actually nerve cells. Like in this diagram here, you see these black lines. They are nerves that start from the pneumocytes, okay, go through the basement membrane, and then they travel to the central nervous system. So what the stretch receptors do is actually they can detect the expansion of the alveolus as we inhale. Okay, so you see the collagen fibers, for example, here, when they are not, the alveolus is not expanding, you can notice that the collagen fibers are all like curled up. Okay, however, when expand, these collagen fibers start to stretch. So the change in the collagen fibers are detected by the stretch receptors, and the stretch receptors will be stimulated, okay, and transmit impulse to the medulla oblongata of our brain. So then when the medulla oblongata receives information that the alveolus has expanded because we are inhaling, so then the medulla oblongata will send instruction to ask us to exhale. So you see, whenever you inhale, you don't continuously inhale. At one time, even if you are doing forced inhalation, you will find that you will have to exhale. The reason is connected to the stretch receptors informing the medulla oblongata, and so the medulla oblongata instructing us to exhale so that the fibers return to normal. Okay, we go to the final adaptation. This is actually related to something that is outside the alveolus, that is the blood capillaries. Okay, each alveoli has a rich network of blood capillaries, and of course the structure of the capillary is just like the alveolus, has a basement membrane and a single layer of endothelial cells. So this makes capillary also thin, just like the alveolus. And the advantage is, of course, it will enable faster gas exchange. Another thing about the blood capillaries is what is inside the blood capillary. You have the blood plasma, which will help to dissolve the gases. And you also have the erythrocytes, which are rich with hemoglobin that can bind to both oxygen and carbon dioxide. So this will enable efficient gas transport. So the blood capillaries not only ensure efficient gas exchange, but also efficient gas transport. So with that, we have completed 7.1A. I will see you, or you will hear from me, in my next video. Goodbye.